today I have the honor of introducing Ryan McIntosh of Ryan Construction. So when you started Ryan Construction, Don, did you pick Ryan's name rather than McIntosh Construction for a reason?
I'll probably let him explain that.
Okay. You're going to explain that?
I'll explain that, yeah.
Okay. Good. Add that to your talk because I'm curious. And we have known of Ryan because of a mutual friend in Edmonds. And today we're just eager to hear what he has to say about transitions in business. He has done a variety of things. How long have you been with Ryan Construction?
13 years,
so a long time, and we're looking forward to hearing how those transitions have worked and what you've learned in the journey.
I'm the Ryan, but I'm not the founder. And when I was a kid, it's mid-80s early 90s is when the company got started. And Ryan General Contractors, actually he wanted a nondescript name. We used to be Steelcraft, and he wanted a business name that was a little more for general construction. And the name actually came about because he's a big fan of Tom Clancy, and the hero in those books is Jack Ryan.
Ryan Enterprises was already taken.
That was already taken. And as I started, I think it was partly for me, because he did realize that maybe I'd want to be in the family business. But anytime my ego would get inflated at any point, he'd remind me where the name came from. So we're a construction company, as you may have figured out, but we're located up here in Woodinville, and we build a lot of churches. That's kind of been our focus for the last 10 years or so. We build somewhere between 8 and 12 a year. I think we've got 4 going on right now, and about 5 others about to start. So it's really our focus in marketing and connecting with people. It's our niche, and we've gotten pretty good over it through the years, so we really enjoy it. On the other side of things, we also do non-church work. We're working with Paul Allen right now for a big museum up in Payne Field for all of his toys that he wants to collect. And we work with Boeing. We built data centers for Amazon. So we do quite a bit of things, but churches are really our focus and our greatest joy. But as I started to put together this talk, I started thinking about. I actually even had a outline, and Matt, I sent that over to you, I think a month ago or so. Really of what I was going to talk about. And it all had to do with the specifics of transition. And, you know, the topic, John told me the topic, said, I think, hey, he knows the story, so I think it'd be really interesting to talk about some of that transition that happened. So about a week ago, I kind of procrastinated since I wrote that outline. I was like, I better revisit that and start coming up with something to talk about here. And as I started reviewing my notes and I started kind of practicing what I'd talk about, I started getting really bored with the topic, quite frankly. I was practicing, and I'm thinking, if I'm bored talking about this, how boring is it going to be for you all to listen to it? So I kind of called an audible, and it actually came last night before my dad left the office. I just said, I'm not all that excited about this material. And he said, well, what do you want to talk about? And I didn't really have it refined at that point, but I stayed around the office. I do my best thinking when nobody's around. So everybody had left. And for a couple hours, I kind of started thinking about what am I really interested in discussing about the transition. I didn't want to completely deviate from the topic, but the specifics that I was talking about, it felt a lot about almost like those, have you ever heard the expression humble brag? Where you kind of talk about, oh, this is what we did, and this is why the transition worked. I wasn't all that interested in that. But I started thinking about what I was excited about, and it's the passion to build churches. That's really what it comes down to. And I started thinking back of when that passion really ignited. And so I kind of went down a rabbit hole on this idea. And it started, actually, I'll just go kind of in reverse back to who I was as a kid to kind of paint the picture of what I was all about. I was a kid that didn't have any passion. In retrospect, I mean, I couldn't tell at the time, but my earliest memories of competing, I loved playing wiffle ball with the neighbor kids. I'd go out there and I'd swing around, and I was good at wiffle ball, and so I thought, well, I should probably be playing baseball, and I played Little League, and I was pretty good at that too. But when it came time to try out for the high school team, I showed up, and there's these kids out there, and they're diving head first. And they're grunting as they hit, and I'm looking at it, and I'm going, this is a lot. You know, these guys are really, they're in it to win it, and I'm just out here to kind of have fun, right? So I remember the tryout, and I was out in the outfield, and this coach skyrockets a pop fly, and the ball is within, I mean, I have to run to go get this ball, but I could have made it. I know I could have made this catch. But instead, I phoned it in, and I instead of really going for that ball, I let it fall before me. And I picked the ball up, and I thought, I don't want anybody to see me catch that ball, because then I might make the team. And if I make the team, I'm going to have to go to practices. I'm going to have all these obligations. I was like, and I'm not into that. So I picked the ball up, and I remember I could have thrown it right back to the coach, but instead I, again, phoned it in, and I on purpose threw the ball a little off target and a little weak, and it kind of dribbled in. I didn't make the team, and that was the success story for me on baseball. Later in high school, I'm a bigger guy, and one of my teachers was the football coach, and he took me after class. He goes, McIntosh, you gotta come try out for this team. We need you on the offensive line. And I considered it, and I was thinking, boy, I know my parents would be really proud if I went for it. So I showed up to that practice, and there's all these guys out there screaming and grunting, and they're on the ground, they're dirty, and they're like, you know, animals out there on the football field. And again, in my mind, I'm going, that's a little much. I want to go home and play some video games, maybe eat some toast. I'm not sure I want to be out here trying out for this team. So I didn't try out, and that was kind of my MO. I mean, school, homework, tests. I remember taking a test in high school, and I knew I was pretty intelligent, but I was more just really not in it to win it from a school standpoint. I remember taking this test, and you know those little Scantrons? You fill in the bubbles. I knew the material, but I got about 3/4 of the way through that test, and instead of finishing, I was kind of going, I'm fried. I've had enough of this. I just guessed for the rest of them. Well, I got the test back. I got every answer right. And the bottom 25% were all wrong because I just guessed at them. And I think back on that and I go, what was going on there? And basically it was a lack of really deeply caring about my success. It was, hey, if I do just enough to get by, that's all I'm after here. And so my dad used to always ask my parents, what are you going to do? I think they were concerned with what I was up to. What are you going to do with your life? What do you want to be when you grow up? And I had no idea. I wasn't interested really in anything. But the answer I'd give them was, because it'd kind of get them off my back, was, I want to be a dentist. And they'd go, okay, you know, that sounds good. The problem is they knew, and I knew, my grades didn't represent, you know, dentistry was not in my future. But I had this thing ringing in my head continually. I need to find my passion. Everybody was saying, follow your passion, right? And I was going, well, something's broken with me because I don't have a passion. My passion is hanging out with friends, maybe playing some pool. It wasn't going figuring out what my career was going to be. It wasn't school related. I didn't want anything to do with his company. The only thing I knew about that was on summers I'd have to go dig ditches out in job sites, and that didn't seem like a fun life. So I kept saying, well, I got to find my passion. So I'm in high school, and I'm watching TV. It's the U.S. Open, and there's this guy, and he is he's being interviewed on the TV, and what basically his story is, I said, you got to come tell your story. 3 years earlier, he was working at Pizza Hut. And his story is every time he got a break or any time it was slow at Pizza Hut, he'd go up on the roof and he would drive balls into a farmer's field behind the store. And 3 years later, he qualified for the U.S. Open and made the cut and finished 14th place, made $2.2 million. Now, the announcer highlights, do you realize that $2.2 million, we've done the math, that's 64 years of working at Pizza Hut. This is a good story for any kids out there watching. follow your passion. As long as you follow your passion, good things will come. Well, I love golf. And as I sat there and I watched this, I go, that is my passion. When I'm golfing the next day, I have trouble falling asleep at this time. I wake up and I'm out there on the putting green, I'm chipping, and I'm passionate about golf. There it is. I'm going to be a professional golfer. So for the next year and a half or so, any opportunity I could get to go to the driving range, I'm out there. Any opportunity I can go out and golf, I'm in it to win it. That's my passion. I'm going to be a professional golfer. I'm going to be on that TV being interviewed about my passion someday. So about a year and a half later, the reality started to set in, because not only did I not improve at golf, I got a little bit worse. I mean, I had no skills whatsoever. And it came to the realization, something seemed a little broken, because I said, now, I followed my passion. And I've been hearing this since a kid. You got to identify your passion and follow it. And I've done that now, and it hasn't worked out for me. So what's happened? So basically what I realized is I kind of resigned to the idea that I probably just wasn't going to pursue a job of passion. So when I got out of high school, I tried college for a couple years, and unfortunately the professors like you to show up every once in a while and maybe take a test, and that seemed like a little bit much. So I ended up getting hired by my dad, and the first job that he gave me was a delivery driver. And I was the wrong guy to be delivering stuff. I mentally was not into it. I was kind of passive, and I'm driving down the road. I'm daydreaming one day, and I've got a load of steel on the top of this big one-ton hydraulic bed truck, and it's a large truck. But I'm daydreaming, and all of a sudden I look in front of me, and all the cars had stopped on I-5, and I slammed on the brakes, and fortunately, the truck stopped in time. Unfortunately, the steel kept moving, and it shot off. Now, it didn't hit any cars. It was close, but it didn't hit any cars. It flew off, dented the top of the hood as it came off. And I pulled over. I pulled all this steel off the road, created an even worse massive traffic jam. And I called my dad, and I go, I don't know what I'm doing here. I'm not delivery driver material. I don't enjoy it. I don't... So the next day, my dad promoted me to the office, and realized, I think he just wanted to get me off the roads and for good measure. And for the next couple years, I kind of just sat around in the office, and every time I was considered a project engineer, supporting the project team. And my dad used to always come into my office and go, Ryan, do you see the name on the door? And he's trying to spark some passion. What do you want to do? And I'm going, I don't know, Dad, this is fine. I wasn't passionate about it. I really looked at it as someday I'm going to figure out what I do want to do. But for now, this is an opportunity. I'm here. And one evening, he's walking past my office. He says, what are you doing tonight? And I said, nothing. And he said, come with me and Patrick. Patrick's our estimator. We got a church interview. We're going to go interview with the church to be their contractor. And so I tool along with them, and we drive to this church, we walk in, we go into this conference room where there's a building committee all hanging out. And within an hour, my dad and Patrick are able to talk with this group. We walk out, and they award us this project. And I'm just kind of dumbfounded watching this process and just completely fascinated by the idea that you could walk into a meeting not knowing anybody, and an hour later, they trust you enough that they want you to build their church project. And I was kind of going, what happened there? What was that all about? And what I realized was, what was exciting to me about that is that I wanted to learn what it was you said that made them look at you in a favorable way. So over the next several months, I'd tag along on these meetings, and I'd read the body language, and I'd see what's effective and what's working. And the biggest piece that I started to realize is that they weren't buying necessarily what my dad was saying to them. They were buying his passion. They realized that he loved building churches. He cared about the success of their projects. And when they saw that passion come out of him, they didn't need to know anything else. And so I started looking at that, and the good news was, I think I figured out how this is all working. The bad news is I'm going, I don't have it. I don't have that passion. But the more he kept bringing me to these meetings, the more I started, it started with just adding a little bit here and there. And before I knew it, we were passing back and forth. And the father and son, the genuine relationship we had was seen by these clients, and they started going, we want this team. I mean, we started getting really good at what we were doing. And as we did, I started realizing the next step of the sales process, which is you create this really fragile relationship with a person, with a committee. And they put so much trust in you to make sure that their project is going to be built correctly. And it's kind of a precious relationship. The worst thing that could happen is we take this, we hand it off to a project team that screws up the whole deal. So all of a sudden, I was really interested in making sure that whoever we were going to pass this project on to knew how important these people were to us. And so I started really caring about who's going to be the project manager, who's the superintendent. And if there were any deficiencies in that team, instead of just being kind of apathetic, I wanted to know what was the problem. I got into the inner workings of that. And the byproduct of that was I started developing relationships with the people in the company. I started caring about their well-being, what made them tick, who is this person, and how can I connect deeper so that I can trust them when they build this project. The other byproduct of caring about the project was I wanted our company to be very healthy. I wanted, so I started getting interested in things like the financial side of things. I wanted to know how our liability insurance worked. I wanted to make sure we had health insurance so all of our employees were taken care of. I wanted to protect this company so that we could be the very best we could be to serve the client. And one morning I woke up and I realized I have fallen in love with this job. I care about everything in the job. I cared about who was going to clean our office, because I knew if a client showed up and our office was a mess, it would reflect poorly on who we sold ourselves as, who we told them we were. So more than that was I found my passion. And part of this has been just the creation of this talk. I've kind of done some forensics on my past to ask myself, when did the intersection between my life and passion hit? And what made this happen? And I started going, it wasn't because I followed my passion. It was almost the opposite. I didn't have passion. There was nothing to follow. But then I started thinking of the idea that, and maybe this is a generational thing. I know it's a millennial thing, but the idea is you always chase your passion. If you're not chasing your passion, you're not living true to yourself. How many people have actually chased their passion and it's led them in the wrong direction? I was fortunate to follow opportunity, which then produced passion. And what I felt was broken at the time, I'm starting to look back in retrospect and think, well, maybe it's not quite as strange of a scenario as I had thought. So what I did, just about any topic in the world you can find online, right? If it's happened, somebody's wrote about it. And I thought, I wonder if anybody else has ever experienced the idea that following your passion is actually not necessary, and maybe in some respects, hurtful. So I typed in a YouTube search last night, and I don't know if we've ever heard of the guy Mike Rowe. He's from Dirty Jobs. Pretty interesting guy. Usually has quite a bit of common sense. I've always appreciated what he had to say. I type in, don't follow your passion, and guess what the topic title I find from this guy Mike Rowe is? Something to the effect of, do not follow your passion, follow opportunity. I chased the opportunity, and the passion at some point intersected. Now, I'm thinking of the advice, chase your passion. Anybody seen American Idol? This is the byproduct, these kids that come up and they have terrible voices. It's not the bad thing that they have terrible voices. I think the average person does. But it's the fact that they want to get up in front of everybody and show their passion, their talent, and they're really bad at it. And we all laugh because this person actually thinks they're good enough to be a professional singer. And when the judges say, you're not going to make it in this industry, they always say the same thing. You're wrong. You don't understand. This is my passion. This is my love. And I'm not going to let anybody tell me that I can't be a success. And the point is as you look at kids, there's the advice that's just blanket advice is always follow your passion is actually perhaps the wrong way to be looking at this. The other thing, from more of a spiritual standpoint, the idea of following your passion is a little bit of a selfish road to travel. And one of the things that I realized that ignited my passion wasn't because I got good at something and I enjoyed something and I benefited from it. Where it ignited for me was the thought that others would benefit from it. I wanted others to get their projects built. And the byproduct of that was I wanted others to succeed, the employees in our company. I wanted to make sure they were good. That, to me, can be very exciting. That's something I could rally around. But everything else that was very self-centered passion, it didn't ignite anything in me. It just felt selfish. And so as I start to think about following your passion, on another level of this is the idea of following your purpose is probably more important. And following God's passion is something that gets me a lot more excited, because if that's the way we're looking at it, we don't have to look at it through the eyes of what's going to benefit us. We're going to look at it from the eyes of who's going to benefit from us. So that was kind of the revelation. And I like to think I'm still sticking with the topic, which is transitions in business. The transition I'm talking about, though, is more in internal. So I actually had another question, and I think the transitions was good to start us off. But how much time do I have, by the way? I have no idea. I've lost all space and time here.
At least 5 more minutes.
5 more minutes, okay. I was curious because I wonder how many people did follow their passion. And I think that's the thing. It's not to say you can't follow your passion. If I was passionate about dentistry and I created a plan and I went for it and I became a dentist, I think that's obviously a success story. My problem was I wasn't passionate about it. I was faking it. But in this room now, Jeff, you said that you were in accounting. Was that your passion?
Not at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
How about your next transition here? Are you passionate about this idea?
I would say that I'm more passionate about the environment that construction brings.
Yeah.
You know, it just is. It's just there's such a you know, such so many moving parts and so many different people involved.
Yeah.
And I'm passionate about relationships.
Yep.
And how they intertwine with each other.
Yeah.
So seeing and in accounting, part of the reason why I wasn't passionate is because I was stuck in a corner and I didn't get to see anybody for 4 years.
Yep.
So just being out and conversing with people from everywhere, from the owner to the guy that's sweeping the floor. I mean, all of that, just the learning in their lives is probably the most passionate thing about what I do.
Yeah. Well, and I think that's as I think about my own daughters, my 9-year-old, is very bright, very motivated, very passionate about everything she does, and we're excited to see what she's going to be and who she's going to become. And I'm always asking her, what are you going to be when you grow up? And she says, well, I want to do one of two things. I either want to be a doctor or I want to be an artist, a painter. And I'm always kind of nudging her, do the doctor thing. And I realize as I'm doing that, I'm trying to influence her passion. And partly I've kind of felt bad about that, thinking that I shouldn't push her towards that. But they took a poll of what is an average millennial's passion, and 70% fell into the category of either artist, professional athlete, or musician. And the bottom line is if your kid comes to you and wants to be in one of those professions, the demographic of America is 0.05% make a profession in those, but yet 70% of people consider that their passion. So if your kid comes to you and wants to be in that bar of 70% of people, it's a little bit disingenuous as parents to say, follow that dream. And that's a little touchy subject, because I'm still a little bit attached to this romantic idea that you chase your passions. But if we're truly going to lead our children, and quite frankly, be leaders in the community, and as young kids come up and tell us what their aspirations are, for us to support just because it's their passion is probably not leading them very good. So I think that's kind of the summary of this. I think everybody has their own path. the idea that we don't all follow their passions is kind of a relief to me, because if we did, we'd all be artists, and I'd be a fireman, or actually I could have been a fireman, but the bottom line is there's jobs that just because we're passionate about doesn't mean we should be following that. So, but I think most stories, even Pat, as you talked about your story, there's times when you get blindsided by the next transition. We don't know what's going to come. We don't know if it's the right fit, but you jump off the cliff, like you said, and you either sink or swim. But sometimes I know in our transition, when the economy hit, it was really rough. And there's a lot of times where we were not sure if we were going to make it. But that was, in retrospect, the fun times. It was the turmoil and the stress and the challenge that comes from that. So I think we can let ourselves off the hook. And your situation, not knowing, it's very normal, I believe. I think it's actually, you're in a really great place to be if that's where you're at right now, because you have all kinds of opportunities, and you'll find it as long as you continue to progress. So, see ya. Yes.
I can't say about what you said, follow your purpose and know God's passion.
Mm-hmm.
Because yep. You can follow purpose, but if you don't know God's passion, then...
Well, what makes me passionate mm-hmm. compared to what pleases God at times can be very contradictory. And so finding the alignment of those two. Have you ever seen Chariots of Fire?
Yeah.
You know, there's that saying as he's running, he says, I ran because I felt God's pleasure in what I was doing. And how many things can we get passionate about that maybe we don't necessarily enjoy, but if we know it pleases God, shouldn't that be the ultimate passion? I think that's another way to look at passion. All right.